the Department of Communications and New Media. Here we call it CNM, and I'm also the director of the new Cultural Research Center. Welcome everyone to the seminar. People from far and near, right? Old friends and my new friends in NUS as well, especially to our international guests from Australia, Associate Professor Fran Martin, from Hong Kong, Professor John Ernie, and from the Philippines, Mr. Cleve Aguelas. So before I begin, I want to, there's a lot of people I need to thank, many partners, right, for making this event possible. The first person I must really thank is Anissa, my postdoctoral fellow. Anissa almost single-handedly organized the whole thing, right? So thanks to Anissa. She organized the program, the speakers, the venue, and the catering. Then I also want to thank my two other postdocs, Wilson Koh at the back and Michelle Ho here, for helping us with the logistics in the weeks and the days leading up to today. And in my department, the new admin team who helped us with the email communications, and especially to the Asia Research Institute for providing this venue for free, and all that stuff to also help us as well. And finally, I also especially want to thank our keynote speakers, Fran Martin from the University of Melbourne and John Ernie from Hong Kong Baptist University for their commitment to our continuing research collaboration. Right. In particular, Fran and John came self-funded from an entity called the Asian Cultural Research Network, and that's based at the University of Melbourne, now headed by Fran. So that unit, you know, kind of flew the two of them here. So Fran, John, and myself have worked together. Well, we've worked together for a long time, you know, for more than 20 years. But over the last 5 years, we've worked together on a multi-university funded a joint research project on young people, mobility, and the media. And this project has resulted in a few research grants and a few special themed journal issues. The new one coming out, forthcoming in the International Journal of Cultural Studies, is entitled Mobilities, Borders, and Precarities in Asia's New Millennium. So today's event, in a way, is the closure of that five-year project and the new beginning of the kind of same idea. New beginning because I'm here now in NUS and in Singapore, and sort of the continuation of that. So this today's seminar continues the theme of media, mobility, and young people, but the new focus then is the focus on digital citizenship. And today is a new beginning as well, because it is the inaugural event for the Cultural Research Center. So the Cultural Research Center, the CRC, is a new research startup incubator, and it's housed in CNM. It's my little center. It's funded by the NUS Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences Startup Grant. So it hasn't been launched yet, so if you haven't heard about it, you haven't missed out on anything. This is our pre-launch event. It'll be officially launched in the next few weeks, so wait for our email blast and our email invitations to invite all of you to come and join us to celebrate the opening of our center. But key to the center focuses on research on culture, right? And the center will bring a new kind of research practice, if you like, to develop projects that are collaborative, that are team-based, that will involve academics from all disciplines, right? From HES, humanities and social sciences, and from STEM as well, the scientists and the engineers, as well as including partners from outside, non-academic partners from industry and government as well. So that's that kind of a research practice going forward in the research center. So the center will just start off with this kind of pilot, you know, incubating activities like a seminar. Then we will bring teams together, and then we'll start to scale it up, and we will go for grants. So today's seminar topic, Digital Citizenship in Asia, is one of these projects currently in incubation. So let me now say a few words about the concept of digital citizenship, because it is a relatively new concept. It has many meanings, it has many applications, also many contested and widely sort of applied, you know, kind of contestations and meanings as well. So the term is situated at the nexus of three kinds of forces, right? Firstly, you know, the kind of pervasiveness of new media technologies in contemporary cultural life. And secondly, the kind of inspiration that kind of is motivated by, you know, the promise of new media technologies, online participation. And thirdly, you know, kind of also bolstered by the kind of online anxieties and fears that are brought about by digital media. So that's it's a new concept, but there's a kind of two or three approaches in this field. The first two, right, that's a kind of contrasting approach, the freedom approach and the control approach, right? The freedom approach, you know, defines digital citizenship as the ability to participate online. And this approach draws on ideas around access and social inclusion. So we see terms like digital participation and digital inclusion. And the view here is that as a result of new media technologies, traditional ideas of citizenship have changed, right? So traditional or normative ideals or ideas about citizenship, you know, what we can call analog citizenship, the kind of one-way flow of communication from politicians and authorities to members of the public, and the members of the public become dutiful citizens and then respond accordingly or may not even respond at all. This kind of analog one-way flow of communication has already been disrupted as a result of new media technology. So digital citizenship then assumes a more multi-layered, you know, kind of interaction, open-ended interaction that will allow and result in negotiation, contestation, you know, of the public, you know, with the powers that exist to control them, right? And this kind of freedom approach has found broad resonance with young people. And young people, the theme of young people is also a theme of what we want to do today as well. There's a lot of studies, you know, there's a lot of youth sociologists in the room at the moment, and a lot of studies have already shown that young people are very dissatisfied with formal modes of civic engagement. They don't even participate in traditional modes of organization anymore. So a lot of them are finding new ways to express their political concerns and participation online. Right, and the contemporary young person has already been called, you know, with terms like networked young citizen, right? The networked young citizen, okay, is someone who, you know, sort of, will not engage in traditional modes of organizing. They, you know, participate online, usually through social media platforms, and, you know, sort of are quite self-reflexive in nature, and, you know, they take up, you know, sort of engagements with lifestyle politics, right? So the networked young citizen then, you know, or in the older parlance, you know, the netizen, if you like, they do not conform to this kind of dutiful model of analog citizenship, but they are practicing, you know, their participation and making claims to their rights through social media platforms. So that's the kind of, you know, freedom approach. The second approach is to think about it in the context of control, the control approach. Here, the young person is kind of thought of as not quite adult, okay? And the things they do online, that practices of digital citizenship, not quite citizenship, not yet. They're not ready because they're young, right? So this kind of framing then provides adults with justification for managing youth digital citizenship. And this is evident in a lot of national projects at the moment around digital media literacy. Adults are given the agency to frame what is considered good digital citizenship. And young people are considered apprentice citizens, right, who need to learn the codes of communication. So here then, digital citizenship is defined through the norms of appropriate online behavior. And digital citizenship education, right, is seen as a way to train or to educate digital natives into becoming good citizens, right? You teach them the appropriate codes of good conduct like one would in real life in social context. Now, this approach has also been criticized by a lot of scholars that it is not really beneficial to the young people that it aims to protect because the focus has always been on harm reduction, on protection, and it doesn't allow them to participate freely and it doesn't even allow them to even have their voices to be heard. And, you know, we've already known it is precisely the exclusion from formal sectors of the public sphere and civic engagement that they are then drawn to online modes of more, you know, informal participation, right? So we have this freedom approach and the control approach. Now, the third kind of an approach is an emergent approach that focuses on civics and civic duty. So here, the digital citizen is one who will use technology to gain political information so that they can participate more fully as a civic citizen on the one hand, but also the digital citizen also use technology to achieve economic gains at work as well. So this definition then stresses the political and economic use of the internet. And of course, the capacity to participate in political and economic citizenship, you know, is also tied to all kinds of capacities in everyday life, access to technology, to education, to technological skills, right? So when we think about digital citizenship in this way, then digital citizenship is really inseparable from the capacity to participate in a broader capacity in society, right? So here, digital citizenship does not really just focus on what they do online, but what they do online is also interrelated to their offline lives as well. And digital citizenship in this context is defined by acts of citizenship, right? So acts of citizenship rather than online participation by itself. So digital citizenship then is both a result of and an effect of making claims to rights, whether those rights exist or not. Okay, so this kind of civics and civic duty approach then, you know, has the potential to challenge the dualism in the first two approach, right? So it's not about whether this is real world or virtual world, whether this is private or public, whether this is local or global, because citizenship, you know, in an online context is inseparable from all aspects of everyday life. So digital citizenship in this context then becomes a platform by which an access, right, by which civic activities in the various dimensions of citizenship are actually conducted. So all the other dimensions of citizenship, so here I'm invoking T.H. Marshall's traditional ideas of thinking about citizenship, economic, political, and social, and also, you know, kind of Toby Miller's work or, you know, cultural studies work around cultural citizenship. So the economic, social, and political, and the social all come together, and digital citizenship is the platform by which all these other claims to citizenship are actually conducted. So that's the kind of three approaches. Today's seminar will, you know, engage with all the debates in all these three approaches and more approaches as well. But today we'll focus on young people in Asia. Why? Young people in Asia make up more than 50% of the world's youth population. And to date, right, if you look at all the studies on digital citizenship or youth digital citizenship, they've only come up predominantly focused on case studies in the West. So we need more work, you know, and there's a lot of work around online activism and so on and so forth, but none of the work coming under the umbrella of digital citizenship. Then why the focus on Asia, right? Because we're here, right? But also, more importantly, Asia is leading the world in ICT adoption, you know, in particular the innovation of smart cities and smart nation. Singapore is a key example. But there is very little scholarship about the region that brings together how young people use technology to engage civic, you know, kind of potential. Again, none of these under the umbrella of digital citizenship. So today's seminar is an intervention to kind of fill this gap, right? So today we have eight very exciting speakers, you know, all leaders in their field, working in the areas of new media and digital citizenship, from NUS, again, you know, with the CRC's kind of research practice of interdisciplinarity. From NUS, we have people from different disciplinary units, from media and new media and communication studies, from geography, from public policy. Outside of NUS, we have our international guests and speakers from the Philippines, Hong Kong, and Australia. So with these opening notes, let me now then introduce our opening keynote speaker, Fran Martin. So Fran was a long-term colleague of mine in Melbourne. We worked together as colleagues for more than 15 years. I think our collaboration began even before we were colleagues, right? I remember, you know, meeting her during our days in graduate school, having reading groups, you know, reading critical texts in each other's houses, right? For months after months we were doing that. So Fran is currently associate professor and reader of the cultural studies program at the University of Melbourne. She's also a competitively funded future fellow of the Australian Research Council. So her talk today draws from her five-year longitudinal project out of this future fellowship, researching international Chinese students in Australia. So please join me to welcome Fran Martin.